like to speak, and then when you come forward, we'll get your name and address for the record. But just, you know, be thinking that you, you know, want to try to keep everybody moving so that we can get everybody who wants to speak the time to speak. You know, just try to not, you know, repeat, you know, the points or whatever as things are, you know, brought forward. You know, that'll help kind of move things, you know, a little bit quicker, and everybody will then have an opportunity to add input. So with that, I'll call on this Hachu here, and we'll get everybody to stand up that would like to speak, and we'll get you sworn in. Oh.
Would you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Okay. And with that, we are out for recess. Mr. Urban just reminded me that of that. So whoever would like to speak first, Mr. Schmidt, I have you down, and go ahead and give us an address for the
Good morning, still morning, good morning.
Maybe get you close to the microphone.
Is this better?
Much better.
Okay. Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate the opportunity to speak here today. I will just say in advance that my topics are difficult. It's a base facts brutally time. So we will proceed. My name is William Schmidt. I was at 1110 Riverside Drive. I'm speaking today on behalf of the now 301 signatories that we have a petition in opposition to the proposed Rose Island Road subdivision. 260 of those petitions were turned in to planning on the 17th of May, and I have to enter into the record an additional 30 copies. 41 more. That's up through today. That was strange. I note that we also have 41 signed, 55 letters of opposition that have been entered into the recorded case file. And included in those letters is a personal letter from me dated the 19th of May, which provides a comprehensive discussion. The discussion of the case of the office for the opposition. So, Mr. Chairman, may I respectfully request confirmation that the commission has received all these documents in sufficient time for review?
With the exception of the petitions that were just received, which we haven't reviewed, all of them have been posted to our website.
Does that satisfy with sufficient time for review?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to begin with an overview of the collective opposition arguments. The petition narrative which accompanied each signature outlined opposition based on several issues. The predominant concern expressed almost universally pertains to Rose Island Road. Almost to a person, daily drivers recounted recurrent frightening experiences to both the roadway conditions and to the consequent behaviors and reactions of drivers. Signatories universally agreed that the proposed development should not proceed prior to completion of major safety upgrades to Rose Island Road, needed because of the increased safety risks from the additional residential traffic and from construction traffic. So frankly, hence people, they were quick to sign the petition. Signatories also concurred with concerns over several other matters that have not been addressed satisfactorily or resolved by the developer or the technical review committees, and we will get into the details of those as we speak. I will have some speakers following me to expound on some of the select points. These concerns include applicability of the proposed stormwater detention basins for low-lying flood-prone areas, septic system contamination of existing freshwater drinking wells, and on-partial stream remediation making the existing drainage problems worse. These and other concerns persist today and are addressed in greater detail in my 19 May letter as well So to summarize, and this is a very high-level summary of the issues that we have brought forward, mostly in my letter, which I hope you all have the opportunity, is an environmental impact study has not been provided as required by Oldham County Environmental Protection Ordinances. Developers proposing individual septic systems for each residence, which is in direct disregard of Oldham County subdivision regulations, which require use of public sewer systems when reasonably accessible. The developer's plat has several significant errors and omissions and is therefore not complete and accurate as required by Oldham County subdivision regulations. The stormwater management system is a highly questionable design for application to the topology of the site, especially considering floodplain areas and the existing water courses on the site. And, of course, the drainage problems that we're concerned with. So now, that's the high level of what our major issues are. Let me move on to a specific focus area, and that being stormwater management drainage system. The proposed stormwater management system, which uses two detention basins to carry stormwater runoff from the subdivision, is flawed for the unique topology of the site. Stormwater runoff is collected and conducted to the proposed detention basins, and that is not discharged directly into the Ohio River, rather out to low-lying open areas for eventual collection by a stagnant, low-capacity Wilberry Creek, which you have seen on the Seasonal Ohio River flooding begins with backup of Little Huckleberry Creek and progresses northward until all roadway access to Riverside Drive and Lower Oldham Acres Road is cut off. That's when it's bad down there, and you have to live on there to appreciate this and proceed with it. Okay, such flooding will likely cause the detention basins located in the seasonally flooded low-lying areas of the floodplain to become silted up and clogged with debris, causing malfunction from their intended function. You got to see it when it happens. All manner of flotsam and debris come floating in on Huckleberry Creek and are left behind when the floodwaters recede, along with inches of mud, which will deposit in these basins. This is likely to create a condition of long-term boggy areas, will result in the perpetuation of a stormwater system maintenance nightmare for the New Homeowners Association, who will not bear the brunt of more of the consequences of ignoring their maintenance obligations. There's little assurance that existing long-standing unresolved drainage problems will not be exacerbated by this development. So, in conclusion, for all of these reasons, and for the additional remarks that will follow, I respectfully request the Planning Commission to deny the Rose Island Glen application. Mr. Chairman, I would like my time to connect the next speaker.
Thank you. Can you turn your address for the record, please?
Good morning. My name is Amanda Schmidt. I live at 1110 Riverside Drive in Prospect. My comments today include remarks submitted to each commissioner via a letter from Janet Dewey of 1100 Riverside Drive. Ms. Dewey is a veteran traffic safety specialist who served as the director of the National Airbag and Seatbelt Safety Campaign, a public-private partnership with the U.S. Department of Transportation. She is not able to testify today, so I am relaying many of her and my own concerns. Rose Island Road is a Kentucky state roadway, which is partially in Oldham County and partially in Jefferson County. Oldham County generally provides routine maintenance. In case you haven't driven Rose Island Road lately, and you did see pictures, but they really don't do it justice, I want to remind you of the conditions current drivers face daily, which include no roadway shoulders, chronic degrading and large edge erosion, no lane edge markings, numerous blind spots and posted hazardous curbs, hazards including trees, fences, and utility poles located within 12 to 24 inches of the edge of the road, frequent presence of deer, real off-road tire damage and side swipe events, storm water runoff and mudslides across the roadway, and often the presence of individual and groups of bicyclists. So you can understand why we feel like we roll the dice while driving this road now, and let alone with nearly 1,000 more vehicle trips a day from Rose Island Glen. The developer has submitted a traffic impact study by Traffic Engineering Incorporated, dated May 10, 2021, which minimizes traffic impact to Rose Island Road and current roadway users. I want to make sure commissioners understand the following. The study is based solely on a calculated total projected intersection delay. I ask commissioners to acknowledge that a criterion of intersection delay is only one component of transportation considerations relative to Rose Island Road. Roadway crashes, existing hazards, lack of shoulders, blind spots, and five existing hazardous curbs are important considerations as well, but are not given consideration in the study. Further, the impact study did not look at the intersection of Rose Island Road and US 42, even though the author states that a projected 65% of the generated traffic will be southbound and pass through that intersection. Also, the report clearly acknowledges that, and I quote, Rose Island Road has not been constructed to modern standards. A clear zone from the edge of the pavement has not been provided. And farther, the roadway needs to be modernized, end quote. The report lists four developer-proposed modest improvements to Rose Island Road to begin to modernize this rural major collector roadway. These are minor improvements offering little offset for the many unsafe and hazardous conditions. But for just these four modest improvements, there is no information as to any commitment by either the developer or the Kentucky Transportation Cabinet to fund them, or any priority rating for those improvements and a realistic timeline. Given other priorities and questionable availability of funds to complete the project, we all know that these improvements could take vastly more than 4 years to complete. Without these changes, the presence of construction vehicle traffic and increased daily trips will place current motorists using Rose Island Road at an avoidable and unacceptable level of risk. The report projects that the development will add 982 daily vehicle trips on Rose Island Road, a 30% increase. When added to the report's estimated 2,500 vehicles per day in 2021, Rose Island Road, in its current condition, is expected to accommodate a projected 3,500 daily trips in Oldham County. Moreover, the total traffic projected by the time Rose Island Road meets US 42 will be almost 4,900 vehicles per day. These projected increased trips do not include construction and projected service vehicle traffic. Regardless of the report's calculated minimal intersection wait time, do any of us actually believe that an unimproved Rose Island Road can safely accommodate a 30% growth in vehicles daily, 1,000 plus more per day? Unfortunately, the traffic impact study did not address the reality of actual vehicle speed. While the posted speed limit is 35 miles per hour, informal observation shows that vehicles frequently exceed this speed, particularly during peak travel times, and drivers traveling south from Goshen use Rose Island Road to avoid River Bluff traffic and backups. These folks are typically in a hurry. If Rose Island Road is currently considered to be a major collector capable of handling 1,000 additional trips a day, then why is the current speed limit only 35 miles an hour? A personal story illustrates this reality. I will admit in front of all of you that I am a heavy foot driver. In the time that we've been thinking and observing carefully Rose Island Road, I have made a concerted effort to drive 35 miles an hour on Rose Island Road. It's hard to do. In that time, I have been passed multiple times. There are no passing zones on Rose Island Road in the park in Oldham County. The only passing zone is in Jefferson County, and it's a very small, short space. It's terrifying to be passed on Rose Island Road in this way. Now, the concern about current vehicle speeds brings me to our overall concern for safety and potential crashes. The Kentucky State Police Collision Data Analysis website shows that since January of 2016, there have been 79 reported traffic crashes on Rose Island Road. This number is different than the one the engineer used, and I believe it's because this goes back to 2016. I think his number was just a bit more current. So 79 reported traffic crashes on Rose Island Road, taking place through the 4 mile segment, and particularly from Kentucky 1793 to US 42. 20 crashes resulted in personal injury, and 59 involved property damages. Please do not discount these property damage crashes, as the difference in an injury or fatal crash versus a property damage only crash is inches, speed, distraction, and pure luck. We also must consider how often Rose Island Road is used by individuals and groups of bicyclists. In fact, Rose Island Road is included in Oldham County's Bicycle, Pedestrian, and Greenway Trail Master Plan of 2008, and is part of the Louisville Loop, as referenced in Webb-based maps of local bike paths. The fact that there are no shoulders on the road, 5 hazardous curves with speed limits posted at 15 to 20 miles per hour currently, and most importantly, 7 to 13 blind spots. From a bicyclist perspective, blind spots and no road shoulders are deadly. Just imagine the horror when a driver stops at a slope or rounds a curve and realizes he will crash into riders. There's nowhere to swerve to the bicyclist. They are realizing the same tragedy. 5 crashes and fatalities happen across Kentucky and the United States. 1 crash in Louisiana on a rural road, a pickup truck slammed into a group of riders. 2 people were killed and 6 seriously injured. We certainly do not want this to happen in our community. In closing, I ask each of you to fully appreciate that your decisions affect far more people in far more ways than you can foresee. Please weigh the potential increase in devastating crashes and injuries to citizens of our community, children and families, brought on by nearly 1,000 more trips daily on Rose Island Road in its current condition. No substantial or intentional increases in traffic on Rose Island Road should be considered until completion of major safety upgrades to this road. For this reason alone, the Rose Island Glen application should be denied for the safety of our community. Thank you.
Thank you. And we're down to about 31 minutes here, so who would like to go next?
I use it just to point on several of my topics. county ordinance and regulation violations, as well as my own personal concerns and those of my neighbor. 23 of the 94 lots are in areas co-zones, partial conservation CO1, and partially residential R2. And this is as depicted on the developer's submitted plat. 25 of these lots are total within the CO1 regulations and designations. The definition and purpose of CO1 zoning is listed in the zoning ordinance section 030-010-CO1, states to promote and protect significant natural features, wooded areas, water courses, existing and potential lake sites, other recreational and conservation resources, wildlife habitat, present and future water supplies, and to minimize erosion of soil and pollution of streams and lakes. Other Oldham County ordinances, including the Oldham County Master and Oldham County Subdivision Regulations, consistently note that zone conservation areas require special and careful attention and consideration for protection when considering development, including consideration and preparation of comprehensive environmental studies. Oldham County Subdivision Regulations, Section 5.9, Standards for Environmentally Sensitive Areas, requires environmentally sensitive areas to be identified on the developer's proposed plat. To my knowledge, this has not been done. The developer has also not provided any statement regarding environmental impacts of the proposed development. How can this be allowed to proceed without full discussion and assessment of this important aspect?
And some of this is, there are some streams that nobody talks about, Huckleberry Creek. There are other streams that feed into that that have not been addressed on the maps that we've seen. Everybody did that, I'm sorry, but that's trying to jump back and forth. Next is the matter of proposed use of individual septic systems for the proposed 94 sites, home sites. This is in direct conflict to the intent of Oldham County Subdivision Regulations, Section 7.4, and I'll paraphrase, where a public sanitary system is reasonably accessible within a half a mile, sanitary system sewers should be installed to adequately serve all lots. The Ohio River Wastewater Treatment Plant and existing lots to it in the Rivers Landing and Yacht Club Estate subdivisions are inside the one a half mile radius of the development boundaries. By the developer's plat, it appears that approximately 28 of the lots are partially in a 100-year floodplain where the septic system could be subjected to seasonal flooding, damage, and dysfunction. This also violates Oldham County Flood Protection Ordinance Chapter 151, and specifically Section 151-069, which clearly intended to prohibit septic system use for developments in floodplain. Consequently, in accordance with the county's own flood protection ordinance, the existing, reasonably accessible public sanitary system must be used in lieu of the proposed development, in lieu of the proposed individual septic system. Now I want to talk about wells. Numerous residents surrounding this proposed development use private wells for drinking water and are located in an active clean water wellhead protection zone. I am one of those residents. With the uncertainty surrounding drinking water safety with close proximity to the volume of proposed septic fields, and when considered together with EPA website guidance for subdivision sites concerning well water protection, project's environmental statement, as yet to be produced, should confirm an assessment of drinking water sources and their safety. To my knowledge, this has not been done. Here's the questions. What safeguards, what monitoring, what remediation if harm to the aquifer occurs? Is anything being proposed or mandated by this development? Who protects this vital resource? It's my understanding the health department focused on the septic system functionality. You know, does the ground perk? What about what it perks to? Has a required groundwater protection plan, a GPP, been developed as per Section 1 of 401 KAR 5.037? That's from the Kentucky Energy and Environmental Cabinet. There are guidelines that these must be in place. So issues that the developer's plat appears to have errors and or omissions that do not conform to the requirements of Oldham County Subdivision Regulations, Section 4.3, regarding the content of plats. One of the significances is that the developer's plat, CO1, R2 zone boundaries, varies from the one shown on the distributed one from Oldham County official zoning map. And that was sent out to the property owners. You know, here's some maps to show you where to do it, and I did find an error, an omission. This needs to be clarified. Which one is correct? What exactly is the zoning for that? As per the technical review committee agency comments, there are some things that have not been met, and they were discussed a little bit earlier. What are the contour dimensions on this map?
If you look, these are not indicated in purple. But this 2 foot and 5 foot, and you start getting into certain areas,
that's quite significant. So we're talking there's 20-foot slope in there. Those are some questions that needed to be answered. Also, there were statements from the agency comments that said that there needed to be labeled areas of substantial existing trees to include a general description of their size and type. A clear admission is the absence of depiction of sensitive environmental features such as creeks, springs, and wetlands on the land parcel, as mentioned earlier. The developer's plat is required to be complete and accurate by Oldham County Subdivision Regulations, Sections 5.9, at the time of submission. This hampers effective assessment of environmental conditions on the land parcels. And I have questions. Should the proposed removal of existing tree branch stands be noted? If you notice on the map for your plots, there is a little down in the bottom, there's something that indicates the tree line with little squiggly marks underneath it to be removed, but I didn't see anything on that. So I've kind of made up my own, if you will. And I would, at this time, I would like to point that out to you, so I'm going to not talk and just kind of point.
But I want, this is the existing tree line.
Without removing some trees. To me, that's a significant now. And that, again, the natural character of the area and the beauty of it.
That's right. I'd just like to ask you, we have about 23 minutes sold.
Okay. I'm wrapping up right as we speak. Because the developer's proposal lacks an impact assessment and environmental considerations, violates the intent of county ordinances and regulations governing sewage systems, and has apparent inaccuracies and omissions on the preliminary plat, the Rose Island Glen application should be and I'll relinquish now to Jeff. Thank you. Thank you all very much for your time.
We'll get back to you here just a moment.
Hello, my name is Jeff Schutz. I live on Oldham Acres, 144 Oldham Acres Road, Prospect, Kentucky. I own a property on Riverside. I have a business on Highway 1793 as well. First things first, I would like to say that I feel that this application is filed is flawed. I would like to say that I see multiple violations of county ordinances. Talked about the environmental studies that, from my understanding, has not been filed. How can this even be considered without an environmental study? This area is so fragile, so amazing out here, so rich. This study has to be completed, it has to be, before even considered. I've lived down here for 21 years. This is my area. I love it. I work here. I'm up and down this road. The most important thing that I would like to talk about is Rose Island Road. Rose Island Road cannot handle a new development, especially per their study, 900 to 1,000 extra trips per day. This road is already dangerous. I'm going to use the word potentially deadly, especially if we have this many more trips per day. I heard the fact about bicyclists. There's so many bicyclists on this road, and I don't know why they come down this road because it's so dangerous. And they're playing Russian roulette trying to get on that road. Actually, we are too. I've been involved with almost 10 accidents over the last 3 years. I've been pushed off the road by a dump truck just 5 weeks ago. Nothing I can do to turn around and get in here to get a license plate or anything because I'm already into a tree. So this happened to me. I got rear-ended. This is 6 weeks ago because I was doing 40 miles an hour. I wasn't doing 35, I was speeding, I was doing 40. This guy, road rage, irritated, bumped me 3 times. I finally got him to pull over, called 911, he goes to Charleston. So down in our area, when you call 911, it goes straight to Charleston, Indiana. So then I got bounced around, the guy gets away from me, takes off. Sideswiping mirrors all the time. The telephone poles are within 3 to 4 inches of the road. We have no white lines, we have no shoulders, we have telephone poles right there and trees. We have this many more too. We're already in danger. We have this many more vehicles per day. I love this all. What I would like to say, and I know you probably won't do this, but I would do this. I would charter a bus, a school bus, to take the entire commission on a trip down Rose Island Road and back. And I feel confident that you guys would not change your mind, but make a true decision on Rose Island Road and how dangerous this road is if you took that route from 42 down to 1793 and then back to 42. It's a very dangerous road. We've got combines on this road, we've got trucks, we've got semis, and we're going to have this development, we're going to have more semis, more dump trucks on a daily basis, and that road can't accommodate. But we can't make those changes because it's a state road. The state road, they might be able to say you can't drive a truck over X amount of weight, but they're not going to say no trucks. They've got nowhere else to go. So we've got to take into consideration about what's on the road. This morning, on my way here, I was going down, I pull up Oldham Acres. By the way, I live on Oldham Acres, so I'm stuck in the middle. I've got no choice to go to Oldham Acres. I've got to go on Oldham Acres. I pull out, I'm going down to the school bus. She didn't see me, and she starts to pull out halfway, and she stopped. She had slammed on the brakes. I see the children on that bus that I know, all of them flew forward, and I'm rushing to get here. I'm not rushing, I'm driving speed limit. But I saw it. It was first hand. This, our Rose Island Road cannot accommodate, this new project. I would say deny, deny, deny. Please do your research and check it out before you guys make this decision. Thank you. My name is Jeff Schuster.
Rains in 15 and 18, it actually raised level on the lawns, sometimes 15 to 20 feet. The Oldham County engineers have been by to see how much water that lake can hold when this reverse flow happens, not to mention the inflow from the other side of the lake, from Cardinal Harbor, we get their runoff too, just to help determine when is it going to affect the 59 homes, $500,000 homes, surrounding the lake. We have a very serious problem right now with flooding, and it's not being handled. Downstream Little Huckleberry Creek is a mess, and building catch basins to collect more water is not going to solve the problem. When the river's above flood stage, I don't care how many days of water it takes to get from Pittsburgh, if it's above flood stage, we've got a serious problem. And it's affecting our community in a very adverse way. In regard to Rose Island Road, as opposed to taking a school bus, I invite anyone on the board to come with me in my grand sport Corvette, and I'll drive them down Rose Island Road and show you what it's like. Or my Tesla, even more. Which, by the way, has had one of the mirrors knocked off because of the truck on Rose Island Road. I was going to make some comments about redraft and possible corruption, but we're all too nice people to do that.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. And in 15 minutes, yes, sir.
My name is Richard Van Cleek. I live at 1630 Victory Court, 40459. The first time testifier, I wasn't expecting you to move the cabinet up for our panel. Very impressive. I, just as a footnote, as I was listening to the arguments, and this is just a side note, I couldn't help thinking about the irony that developers always name their developments after the thing they're just about to destroy, in this case, Brent. The theme of my thoughts are based on one British saying which has become adopted widely here in Kentucky, and that is three words, horses for courses. I won't go through most of my comments. I'll say I want to associate myself with the previous comments. It's the break. Rose Island Road is just simple math. Dangerous now. Route 42, when it goes from four lanes to two, every Oldham County is so traffic jammed now every day. It's already forcing more traffic on Rose Island Road. If you add to that this new development, and I hear the number of 900 and something new trips, but as someone else said, add FedEx deliveries, lawn services, Lowe's trucks, Amazon deliveries, it's exponentially bigger than that. And these are wide vehicles on the railroad. It's just simply a fact that we're exponentially increasing the danger on Rose Island Road. And I'd also like to say that the mitigation suggestions by the developer are fine, but they're just confined right in front of where the development is. I would ask, what about the other 95% of Rose Island Road? These are real, as somebody who drives it regularly, but now I think twice before I turn onto that road because it is dangerous, even today as we speak. And I'm sure most of you have ridden on that road, and the undulations and curves are significant. And these changes, not for one or two or 8 years, as they say, to develop. These changes are forever. It's a very serious thing. 1793 is really not an escape route. Anyone who's driven on their nose to the bottom end of 1793 is continually a problem for the development, for keeping the road up. The sides fall off regularly. Boulders are falling down. Floods come through. Major rocks fall off there. So that's already a problem. Even on my way here today, 1793 has traffic jams. The school opens and closed. You can't, I stuck for five. I just urge you, for the sake of the safety of residents and anyone who would visit, and just for the sake of common sense, to please not go forward with this development.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning. My name is Christopher Wyatt. I live at 9207 Rainbow Springs Court, Louisville, Kentucky, 40241. I'm here today to bring to the attention of this committee the archaeological and the historical significance of this land. I'm an independent researcher, and I also study the antiquities and histories of Kentucky. And I grew up in the area off Oldham Acres. My great-grandfather, Merle Lyle, he lived on Oldham Acres, and he told me when I was a child that there were Indians buried out in that field. Since then, I've done some research, and what I have found out is that on Rose Island Road, where the proposed widening of the road, that there is a mound located in front of 1301 North Rose Island Road. There is a cemetery placed on top of that Indian burial mound, which belongs to the Trigg family, and it's registered as Trigg Family Cemetery Number 2. Also, on the western tract of the land, there is a circle of trees with a depression in the center of that, which we are under the impression that that is what's called a karst depression. It is the remnant of an Indian burial mound. Since we're pressed for time, I'm just going to keep this brief. I believe that a full and complete archaeological survey is needed before this development, that that LIDAR technologies and ground penetrating technologies should be used to determine the layout of this land and what is under the ground. That is basically all I have to say. This land, as many of you already know, that Harmony Landing was the first seat of Oldham County. There is historical significance to that land. And the reason it was called Harmony Landing was because it was noted when our earliest settlers came here that they called it that for a reason, because of the tranquility and the beauty of that land. There is historical and archaeological significance there. So there should be an archaeological survey done. Thank you.
Go next, please. And next, Bob Coons. My name is Bob Coons. I live at 1122 Riverside.
What's your last name? I'm sorry.
Your last name? Coons, C-O-O-N-E-S. I've been on Riverside Drive for 34 years. We came out to visit friends often before that. And in all those years, I've never seen any improvements other than repaving. The road was designed and built to carry very little traffic. Farms all around, and then you get going after each Oldham Acres and Harmony Village, which they were camps back then, and people just came out on the weekends in warm weather months. So it just didn't generate much traffic in those days. Well, in all those years, not to beat the dead horse, but the road just hasn't been improved. It's been repaved several times, and that's it. But over all those years, new subdivisions like Riverland, River Glades, the Reserve, and the condos on Victory Court, the Yacht Club Estates, and Rivers Landing. Plus, a lot of those camps, they're permanent residences now. So the traffic has picked up. And as inadequate as it is during the day, it's even worse at night. With all the hills and curves, cars coming over out of nowhere, out of the darkness, and their lights hit you, and just the angle that their lights hit you, it's temporarily blinding. When it's going to be repaved a couple years ago, I asked the transportation cabinet if they could put white lines down there. And they said the road doesn't meet their own specifications for adding white lines out there. They can't do it. So they said it's just unsafe. And they're right, the road's not wide enough for concrete trucks, pump trucks, box trucks, flatbed trucks, all of heavy equipment, and stay in their lane. They just won't fit. They've got to go over the yellow line, or they've got to go off the road. It's just the way it works. US 42 a couple weeks ago, and it's just a little 9-second clip that I'd like to show you. Yes. If you can see that, there was a flatbed in front of me, and we can replay this in a second. A car was coming towards him, and he was almost off the road. In fact, he was so far over, I thought he was going to go off the road, whip around, and keep on me. But the truck with the heavy equipment on it, it scared him too. And he goes off the road. And he has to whip it around. You see him get sideways and take up. He goes way over the yellow line that they're trying to get control of. Only a couple of seconds. If that car had been just a little bit later, he would have been hit. If there had been a car right behind him, he would have been hit. A very serious injury, at least, when a truck like that hits you. There's one other thing that we were talking about. Can you bring this over? This is a 1793 on June 29th of 2020. After a rainstorm. It's not showing up there too good. There's the water. Water gushing down 1793 when they were talking about washing out boulders and rocks onto 1793 and down Rose Island Road where they are. There's what you get with a heavy rain. It wasn't a flood. It was a June 29th rainstorm. So I hope that for the safety of Oldham County citizens and anyone else who travels the road, I'd like for you to please deny the application to Rose Island Glen subdivision and any others until this whole 4-mile stretch of the road is brought up to modern day scenes. Thank you, sir.
Come in.
I was up here earlier as a private citizen. I'm now here before you as the president of Harmony Village Homeowners Association. Bill Hildebrand. 1104 Riverside Drive, Prospect 4005. So we had a meeting this past Saturday. We did not have high attendance, but we did have a vote regarding this development. We had 7 votes against the development, 6 for the development, and 3 that didn't care one way or the other. I just want to present that for my obligations.
All right, anyone else? We're down to about 4 minutes here. Anyone else that would like to testify or any questions? Yes, sir.
Good morning. My name is Dan Weaver. I live at 13905 North Bell Vista Court, Prospect, Kentucky, 40059. That's in the Cardinal Harbor subdivision, which is about 2 subdivisions north of the new proposed. Listen to quite a few people here today that the consensus is pretty much the way I feel about this. I'm not opposed to growth. I'm not opposed to subdivision. What I am opposed to is Rose Island Road cannot accommodate 94 more homes and 900 to 1,000 more trips per day. The road is narrow. It's dangerous. You've heard of accidents happening. It's going to get worse. 3-foot shoulder, that's what I'm hearing. In front of just the subdivision, the new subdivision, is not going to cut the mustard for the entire length of Rose Island Road. It's not just 150 feet of frontage there that's going to affect the whole road. There's been several subdivisions added. You've heard that there has not been significant improvements to Rose Island Road, if any, other than repaving. The trees are so close to the pavement now. Utility poles are 6 inches from the pavement. I almost hit telephone poles going down through there myself several times. There's heavy deer traffic, the flooding situations, river drainage. Believe me, I'm accustomed to river damage. I live right on the river in 97 and 2018, and 4.5 feet around my back wall. So it's not just water coming down from Pittsburgh, it's water coming from anywhere north. Believable. that's going to affect that area. I'm very concerned about the drainage situation and the lack of planning that I'm hearing. Water is a serious issue and it should be taken into consideration. I would like to see more studies done. I mentioned the traffic flow. If I heard correctly, the last traffic accurate flow was done in 2017. It's 2021, so there needs to be some upgrades on that. I'm opposed to the subdivision the way it stands now, unless something significant is done to Rose Island Road.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've got about a minute and a half. Anybody else have anything they want to add here or anything? Okay.
The office still stands. I'll take you in the bed. This is a good time.
All right. We will we'll move into the questioning of the applicant, those opposing the application by the commission. We have 30 minutes. So, commissioners, who would like to go first? Yes, Ms. Bonet.
Shoots and 1793. Once again, my business is just at the bottom of this hill, just down on the left. So I always send my trucks this way to keep everybody off of that road. This is the safest way, but it's the road. You see the state out there working on it regularly, but they cannot keep up with it. The boulders off of that hill, especially after a flood, off that cliff, they will drop into the road. I wish I was more prepared. I would have a pinch for you. This section of the road right here is horrible. In my opinion, on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad it is, I'm going to put it at 7.5.
The rocks you're talking about entering the road, are you talking the whole length of the road or the bottom of the hill?
I would say starting from halfway down all the way to the bottom after a big flood. When I say flood, after a big rain, down at the very bottom, it's completely covered. If the state is not up there quickly, we're not going to move the rocks ourselves. And we're not talking real rocks, we're talking big rocks that fall into the center of Rose Island Road and 1793.
And the patching that I'm seeing down the right hand side, it's hard to tell, but is
patching is
horrible. Is the width of that road similar to Rose Island?
Yeah.
Wider?
And this is wider. This is much wider than Rose Island Road.
But the patching is terrible.
The patching is terrible. Absolutely terrible.
And it's unhandy.
Terrible is in bumpy, or terrible is in degrading, or terrible is...
Terrible is so rough. It forces people to
the
limit.
I'm sorry, I need the gentleman at the mic to answer the question. I can't hear otherwise.
I would say worst case scenario. It's like massive potholes. It is deteriorating underneath, as well as just massive potholes all the way down.
Okay, thank you. I just want to hear a little about this, because we heard so much about Rose Island.
We did watch that video. That happens all the time. Over on the left-hand side, that has been done probably the last 4 years. They've added that and cut into the side of the mountain there and took it down. The water floods out into the road, so there's no going down that road or coming up that road during these big rains. When I talk about rain, I'm just talking maybe 2 inches.
Does that answer your question? Anything else that you have? Okay. Anyone else? Questions? Yes, Mr. Bradley? This would be for Mr. Silverman.
Good
before we have any collisions, and what period of time that 20 collisions, I think, before those out?
About a 3-year period.
A 3-year period?
Right. That's standard for our investigations, 3 years.
All right. Second of all, Rose Island, does the state have, that you know, any plans to improve that any time soon?
I'm not aware.
And the other third question, is there an environmental impact statement that has to be made on this piece of property? If that's on
you? I would need to research that part.
Thank you. Okay, Ms. Payne?
I have a question for Ms. Zimmerman, please. You have, the picture is on the screen here. Do you have an idea of what the grade is on 1793 there?
I
do not. Do you have just speculation? Have you traveled that road?
Yes.
Would you call it steep?
No.
What?
We live in Kentucky. I've driven on significantly steeper roads in the state of Kentucky. Is it as steep as anything in Oldham County? Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Commissioner, anyone else?
Question.
Yes, Ms.
For the developers. Is there, is sewers available and within a reasonable distance?
Speak of the microphone closer to you.
Is the sewers available at a reasonable distance to this development?
The sewers are, there's a wastewater treatment plant on the other side of River Bank.
Is there a reason why you didn't put sewers into the development rather than using septic systems with all the water around?
There's no sewers extended in this direction beyond that project, so to extend the sewers to this piece of property would require this project to be substantially larger.
The reason I ask that is the other gentleman talked about a 300 unit, and surely they would have had sewers there to put 300 units in there. So they must be reasonably available to be able to do that.
I've had the opportunity to look at this extensively for lots of developers, and to have sewers in this project as required over 300 lots to extend sewers for this project. There's a cost. Everything has a cost associated. There are no sewers extended in this project, so it becomes the cost of the development, which then makes you have to have more lots. So we try to come up with a conservation, a conservative plan in this project.
Thank you.
Any additional questions? Ms. Bettis.
My question will be, I guess, to the developer. Who should probably answer? Who made the decision on the 3-foot extension for the,
the state? We met, Diane Zimmerman and myself met the state representative out there, and he told us that we were, that's what they would prefer. They would prefer a paved 3-foot shoulder, then the transition down. And when we do that, we of course have to clear the trees.
And that's standard building minimum county standard. And my next question would be to you is, what's the width of the road going to Carmen River? I know you're
serious. One of the 13 feet.
So, how many feet is it from the actually from Flyway down to Riverside?
In our mind, it's the county standards through our entrance and then transitioning back to the normal road.
Past the property line?
Past our property line, correct, yes. Well, on the right side, on the left side, we got property. old subdivision like this, I'm guessing probably about 10 to 12%. Remember, these are large lots. These aren't your 6,500 square foot lots. So I mean, by the time you factor in 1 to 2.5 acre lots, it's probably around 10%.
And
yes.
I'm assuming we're waiting for this comment.
Yes.
And Kenneth, do you know, is there an environmental impact requirement? I'm up with county staff that we didn't know if it's a requirement.
There is one required at the construction plan phase, so we will submit a Corps of Engineer of review, individual order of review. So as part of the construction plan, we will have an environmental assessment.
And same thing with the archaeological historical study.
We've looked at the state maps. There's no indication that on any of the state maps that we've looked at that would require.
My next question, I guess, would be for one of our staff members regarding the plan. I just need a clarification that the neighbors expressed several times that they felt like there were errors on their plan and there were certain ordinances that were not being met. I'm assuming everything has been reviewed by county staff. So is there anything about that we need to know more on it, or are you in agreement that they are actually planned?
I'm in agreement that they have all been met. Where the issue with the zoning map may occur is here we have the zoning map that is presented on our GIS. This isn't survey quality, so the lines might be just a little bit shifted off, but we don't use this as a survey. We require the applicant to provide a survey showing the exact location of the zoning map. So this is a reference they provide with the survey.
Okay, and is there a conservation easement on the plan?
Not that
lawyer.
Okay. And I think my next question.
Just that CL zoning doesn't make it a conservation easement. So to the best of my knowledge, there is no conservation easement.
Not required. I mean, thank you. My question is there any opportunity for a diesel lane going into the
Well, there would be opportunity for one, but there's not sufficient volume. The volume generated by this development, in addition to the volume already using Harmony Village, does not meet the volume requirements that the state would require the turn lanes into the development.
Thank you. That's all I have.
Okay. Any additional questions from staff? I'm sure the commissioner has some. Howdy, Ms. Fine.
The gentleman that came up and spoke about the archaeological.
Yes.
Basically, I just want to know, you mentioned a tree family cemetery. Is there any documentation showing where that is located?
I have found that, but I do not have it with me today. I'm kind of open for that. But I did find that in Oldham County Registry of Cemeteries.
So is it on a plaque or a map?
There are tombstones present, and they are placed on top of what we believe to be an Indian burial mound that is situated in front of the Miller, the Robert Earl Miller residence. He just passed away last year. I do not believe his wife is even living at that residence, so. But
I'm sitting right here. Basically, I just wanted to know how you knew it was there. So that's all I needed to know. I just wanted to then ask the developer if he was aware of the location of how. I mean, it's not showing on the plat as far as I can tell. So
I was okay.
Thank you.
I will add to this, and I'm using this because I believe he's talking about the property across the street that we do not own. So it's not on this property.
Okay.
talking about some properties over here.
My name is Chris Foster. I represent Teresa Construction Company, which is an S corporation. It has three shareholders. We own the property. So any questions you might have for me, I'm happy to answer. Getting back to the topic at hand, this piece of property, right about here, is where Bob Miller's house is. We don't own it. We own this bypass section over here. And this section here, just for the sake of accuracy, it was sold back to the people that live up on River Crest Drive last December. I think we closed on that last December because they wanted to buy that property so that they could enhance their views and cut trees, and we accommodated them.
So you're not aware of any graveyards that are located on your property?
No, ma'am. And that property's been in my family. I grew up 67 years old, and that property's existed in our family as an adjunct to Cardinal Ridge Farm, which is where Cardinal Harbor is now located at my grandfather's farm. So I have a survey with me, a recent survey that was done of the property, and it shows nothing in that nature.
Okay. And I just have one last question before
Property
developer or Kevin Young. Can you just explain to the layperson how a septic system will work on those blocks that seem to be, I know there's a building pad outside of the floodplain, but like lot 11 in the rear of the property, how does that work having a septic on there, and is there any sort of groundwater protection you have in place for the folks that are on well water?
There is, and actually, a lot of that floodplain area works very well for septic fields. The intention, of course, is when you have a septic field that you get a lot of transpiration, which you can get some that go down into the ground. So septic fields typically are located in the lower fields, farms, when you do the subdivision, especially the large lot subdivision. I would say that's very typical of the location. So we have done that help. We've had the health department out here, we've done a septic field dig. We do that before we come to the TRC meeting. So, as expected, these soils are very good for septic. They're very receptive. So, we've got that. The health department in their letter, I think he says he wants a 70-foot clear zone from any wells. So, he monitors that. And I say he, I'm sorry, I don't know your health department, I don't know your memory, but that is his responsibility. It's something he needs plumbers and when we locate the septic.
Okay, thank you.
All right, any additional questions?
I think you've got in your packets the TRC meeting minutes, and he's referring to Charlie Ward, and there are three bullet points in the TRC. I'll read real quickly. Perform the site evaluation on March 5th, 2021, when the soils are suitable for septic systems. Second one is an individual site evaluation will be performed for each lot to ensure the system is sized correctly for the home. And then the third one is septic systems have required setbacks from wells. Tank is 20 feet.
Additional questions? Seeing none, we'll now move into the rebuttal evidence and cross-examination by the applicant. Good evening, Mr. Young.
This is Sergeant Paul, I fill in where I miss. So what I did is I tried to do is keep a list of all the questions, and then I tried to summarize. So I'm trying to keep some time. When I start grading, I'm not going to jump back and forth, just to keep some close to the answering of the question. So the first thing I wrote is storm drainage. Improve the existing conditions was one of the questions. We are taking on the improvement of mail lanes. Stormwater pipe is undersized and storm events and water goes across, flows out of the road, and causes a safety concern. We talked about as part of this application, we are not required to do improvements on Rose Island Road per the state regulations. That doesn't mean that we don't need to do improvements in alleys with minimal volumes on them are on the lowest pecking order of the improvements and roadways. You hate to say it, but this is the way roads work. The more volumes you get on roads is when the state starts to turn attention to fixing the roads. Highway Department told us that. So I'm going to continue with drainage and come back to that. So we're taking on the Mail Lane drainage improvement, stormwater detention, floodplain capacity. We're trying to do everything. If it was 1.75 made the situation better, we have the ability to do that. We use the number of 1.5 to 1. It's required 1.1. We have 50% above capacity. What that does is two things. On a normal storm event, it provides additional capacity to help the folks downstream of us. We also try to pay particular attention to our neighbors that are getting the direct discharge from the Oldham. So we took that water to our detention basin and let it, instead of letting it directly into their side yards. So that's something we're trying to do. It ultimately ends up in the Little Hook. All this water ultimately ends up in the Little Hook area, which then ends up in the Ohio River. The situation from the major floodplain is the Ohio River. We're not solving that situation, but what we're trying to do by the proposal is to address additional capacity in this system. One thing with the point of discharge, you're going to just erode. Well, what we do when we locate these detention basins is we naturally, if you go out there today, after walking back into the trees and on the side of the farm building, you can see where the water discharges today. It has created a point of discharge. Our points of discharge for these detention basins are located in the natural drainage feature. We're not creating a new point of discharge. We utilize the existing point of discharge. So basins 1 and 2 utilize those points of roadway capacity. Diane, I asked, I went back and saw me get up. Diane said the capacity of Rose Island Road is 8,000 cars. Currently, with this development, it's about 3,500 to 4,000 cars. The capacity for the roadway, what anybody's arguing, is there. It is the safety concern. So we have taken the steps to take the Mail Lane Bridge improvements. We've taken the steps to improve our frontage 150 feet on both sides of our entrances. Added a second entrance to help distribute traffic toward 1793. We're making that same commitment to widen the road in that location. This is in concert with the Kentucky Department of Transportation. I also try to keep the Oldham County folks in tune because we're here, but it is a state road. So I've been taking this to the state highway department with the assistance of Diane to come up with recommended approvals that the state is in support of. Environmental. But one more thing on roadway. All of our roadway improvements happen as part of phase one. So roadway improvements, as part of this project, happen in phase one. We're not putting off roadway improvements 3 and 4 years. It's part of our phase one improvements. environmental, ultimately, we will end up with construction plan permits from the Corps of Engineers, Division of Water, Jim Silliman, the Oldham County Engineer, Kentucky Department of Transportation will review, Fire Department will review, Oldham County Health Department will review, or maybe somebody else I'm missing. But these plans go through a rigorous review process to address not only environmental, stormwater, and sanitary. So but those are issues that at this point we're at a preliminary plan phase. I did miss the 2 foot, they are 2 foot contours. They typically label 2 foot at this scale. It's hard to see them, but so I should have highlighted those stronger. So I apologize for that. Zoning, part of the property Jim mentioned, CO1 and ag. Our plan here is no waivers or variances. We meet the regulations. We designed the subdivision to meet the regulations without sanitary sewers. I hope I touched on the sanitary sewers to let you know what the thought behind that. We think this is a very reasonable subdivision. 300 lots or plus of sanitary sewers here. It could be, there's a whole additional issues that we would have to be addressing. So I think we tried to, and the homeowner and Steve, or the existing property owner, realized that this is something that needs to be protected. We talked about archaeological survey. I went back after the neighborhood meeting and researched. I saw no indication of any features of something. A tree protection. We have made a commitment to provide basically close to 50 acres of open space, and the only trees being removed in that are going to be from the detention basins. Our Little Hump area is being protected with the trees adjacent. 35-foot tree preservation on our property on Rose Island Road. The intent is, again, to keep that existing tree canopy in place as best as possible. When we talk finding elements, and I know we'll probably get into more detail, we tried to put a bowl around, we tried to address what we heard in the neighborhood meeting. Mr. Schmidt provided a very comprehensive outline of questions, 3 or 4 pages. Try to go through each and every one of those and address those, and not as best we can. We don't have answers for some of the floodplain of the highway, but we try to address this concern. I know Steve has personally tried to talk to each and every neighbor he can talk to see if he can do anything to make this the best plan we can. We think we have a very good plan here.
I'll be very quick because Kevin did address most of the concerns, and actually all of them. And I just want to reinforce that with respect to construction traffic, the binding elements 11 and 12. We proposed there in our binding elements, all the construction traffic will have to use 1793. A lot of the concern that you've heard about the traffic conditions on Rose Island Road deal with driver behavior. That is something that we can't really fix. It is something that needs to be addressed with Oldham County Police. I've driven the road myself, and I always, especially now that I'm so old, I drive the speedway. So I see in my rearview mirror the rude gestures and the tailgating that goes on. There's no fixing stupid. So we're doing all that we can to address the storm damage. The conditions on Rose Island Road to the extent we can do so in conjunction with KTC. This property, it potentially could be much more intensely developed, and this is a very conservative plan, and I think it's one that you should seriously consider giving you approval. And also, before I forget, you note that the traffic study numbers, the 1,000 trips, that's on full build-out. That's when it's fully occupied. So that's going to be quite some years now, and I think there's a lot that can happen probably with KTC in the interim. But this is a conservative plan, and I hope that you will give it your consideration. And thank you so much for your time and attention today.
Thank you, and you will have an opportunity for a final statement. And now we'll move into rebuttal evidence and cross-examination by the opposition. Who would like to? We have 10 minutes.
I'd like to speak to the sewer system situation.
Just be aware that there might be some other folks that also.
The county ordinance, I would encourage all of you to read it. It's in the subdivision regulations, section 7.4. I'm not going to read it to you. You need to read it for yourself and come away deciding whether you think it indicates that there is intent to go with the public sewer system if readily accessible. Definition being a sewer plant or lines to that plant within 1/2 mile. And that criteria is met it says any boundary of the proposed subdivision within 1/2 mile of a sewer line to a plant or the sewer plant. And we're right at 1/2 mile on the sewer plant, and we're about quarter of a foot to 1,000 yards from existing sewer lines. That's what the regulation says.
commission has the ministerial responsibility and to make a determination here, but I submit to you, you should review that carefully. And to go further with respect to the question I believe you asked about the septic fields, if you will, okay, it's very difficult to see on this with the lights up, but if you look at the floodplain boundary, you will see that there are 27 of these lots that are partially in the 100-year floodplain boundary, okay, and that's on the back side of the lot. The house is going to be on the front. Septic system is going to be where? On the back. Okay. If you look at, again, the Flood Protection Ordinance, Chapter 151, specifically Section 151.069, it clearly is intended to prohibit septic system use for developments in a floodplain so as to preclude utilities and septic systems from being underwater for significant periods of time from annual seasonal flooding. Clearly the intent of Oldham County regulations to not put septic system anywhere in a floodplain. It's absolute. In fact, the ordinance doesn't even mention septic system. Now I'll turn to the stormwater system.
Well, let him hear and then I'll let you.
With respect to stormwater system, let me reiterate again. The reason I consider that the system is flawed is not because of its design, the 1.5-to-1 margin, and that kind of business. It's what happens when it floods and what is the consequence thereafter. The flotsam and jetsam coming in and silt plugging up the basins, plugging up the system, and the fact that the homeowners association is going to be responsible to get down there and clean that up, where we, the local residents on Riverside Drive, do that right now. Okay, when the mess comes in, we clean up the mess. That's going to be the responsibility of the homeowners association, and it's going to disable that system. It will not work until it's cleaned up. And you can argue all you want about, well, what's the timing of the water that it comes down, and, you know, all that kind of business. But the fact of the matter is the system is going to be disabled after flooding. It's not going to work. And I'll close by saying what we have here is an absolutely magnificent proposed development, something that we can all be very proud of. It just happens to be in the wrong location because of the access to it by Rose Island Road.
All right, anyone else have a button? We've got about 5 minutes here.
Joe Copaz, Oak Rivers, I mean, God. Got the New York Times from yesterday.
This is really rebuttal. I'm writing this by saying that
no one has predicted, and I guess plenty of us, you should do something on TV, but the NOAA has stated that the 30-year precipitation rate has increased for this area by 9 inches.
And so, you know, this is rebuttal. The evidence has already been presented.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. All right, yeah. Well, it's just that whatever they plan for 1.5 is not going to be enough.
All right. That's it. Anyone else?
Does Greg say my name?
Yes, no, you're just my name.
Richard, in regards to the recent comments that the problem wasn't really this driver behavior, I'd just like to point out that driver behavior in bad happens on all kinds of roads. Present on wide roads, four-way highways. The issue here is that it's something extremely dangerous and narrow road. And the other thing I want to say is that to rebut the reported report that there would be no traffic effect that goes out on the road from the state, I respect everyone's work, but that seems like a
anyone who has driven road blocks.
Got about 3.5 minutes here for the fun.
Christopher Wyatt. I must point out real quick that you said that there is an archaeological survey on this land, but you said that you checked it out yourself. So there either is an archaeological survey or there's not. You contradicted yourself. And I must point out that before this proposal goes through, that there must be an archaeological survey done on this land. I don't know what else to say. So if there is an archaeological survey that has been completed, could you make that readily available?
We'll take that up here in 5 seconds. So. All right, got about 2.5 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Jeff Schutz. I just want to come back to the environmental study. If it has not been done, which has not been submitted, highly recommend that they do an environmental study. It was also said about the river coming up and flooding, you know, making everything happen with up there. It's not. It's from up on the hill. All the water coming down is what gets the Huckleberry Creek. And that's what floods out the little houses down below, Riverside and Oldham Acres. My friends and neighbors down there get swallowed up all the time, even on just little rankings. This has to be done because if the environmental study is done, it's going to show, you know, everything else that needs to be looked at. How do you recommend the environmental study? Thank you. Thank you. All right, we have a little less than 2 minutes. Any additional rebuttal? We'll now move into the final statement of the opposition, and we have 5 minutes for a final statement.
I will reiterate, I admire the design of the subdivision. I would very much like to live next to it.
Jeff, you need to get closer to the microphone.
But, great subdivision, wrong location, terrible access, significant problem with the road, with no hope of it being fixed in any rational time by any plan or any budget. Stormwater system, I believe, is defective. It will not work. It will be a nightmare to be maintained because of the seasonal flooding that occurs. It will be stopped up, clogged up, muffed up, and turned into a boggy, muddy, mosquito-laden mess. And the folks up the hill who will be responsible for taking care of it, well, I certainly hope they do, but we've seen what happens in other scenarios where that responsibility resides with the homeowners association. It's not well discharged. I will also come back to the environmental study question. You may say, environmental study is not required. I submit, I believe, by the intent of Oldham County regulations, and I cite a chapter and verse in my letter, it is required and should be done and should be available to you folks in your ministerial duty here to be able to have that information at your disposal before you make any decision, not after, not later. And that brings me to a third point. I know this is long-standing practice, but the engineering work that is done by the various regulatory agencies, like the Corps of Engineers, everybody who was cited as a permit having to, they have to get a permit from, okay? Wouldn't you folks like to have the benefit of that being done before you made a decision whether or not to proceed? Yeah, I know. It would be a real tragedy for you if you got into this and suddenly discovered you had an intractable problem that could not be resolved. Believe me, they're out there. You know, at least 3 construction things that have been shut down because of four engineer permit issues, and they just quit and had to walk away from the job. I would hate for you guys to match yourself in that situation. So, what can be done about the existing process where that stuff is done, pun intended, downstream in the process, and get that up front so that you all, as part of your ministerial duty, can have the benefit of that information. I don't know how to fix that problem. It's kind of an incongruous
you. You know, we there might well be intractable problems that would be discovered as a result of environmental impact statement. Every developer in the state takes that risk. That's why some of them do go broke, and some of them do very well. And Mr. Canfield has to take that risk. The environmental impact study is by regulation required during the construction phase. We will be doing that. But with respect to the detention basins, with the flotsam and jetsam that it accumulates during the flooding events, we have offered our own binding element to the effect that that will be kept maintained and clear at all times, including during flood and storm events. So that will be the obligation of developing and construction and bringing when it comes over the project to the homeowners association, it will be for the homeowners association. And we can also see to it that that obligation is not only reflected in the binding elements, but in its conditions and covenants and restrictions that are filed along with the record of plat of the subdivision. I think we've heard a lot of discussion about what if, what might happen, but we acknowledge that Rose Island Road has its limitations. But this is a very conservative plan. It's absurd of what others have proposed. And I think it is one that should be approved. And I hope you give it good consideration today. And again, I want to thank you for all the time that you spent in dealing with this proposal. Thank you very much.
Is that complete your final statement,
Dan? I do want to reserve one objection to the evidence of the petition. We can't cross-examine that, so I will reserve that as an objection.
All right, commissioners, the docket PZ21-010 is completed at this point, and we're at noon. Do you all want to go ahead and walk through our discussions and consideration on this docket, or do we want to break for lunch, or what's the feeling of the patients? Move on? Okay. All right, at this point, I'm going to call on Mr. Urban. There are several binding elements that have been proposed, and I would like to get those put on the screen here for us to look at, and as we always do, then we'll move through the process of making a decision.
We've done this a little differently today because we knew that there would be evidence presented that could turn into binding elements rather than proposing them in the beginning or the staff report. We decided that the best way to do it would be to present them towards the end. And I've actually modified what you're going to see on the screen based on your testimony and evidence. So there are actually, I believe, about 19 potential binding elements. We have written them out, Tom. You have them. I can put them on overhead or that one sheet. I'm going to start reading them because some of them are typical binding elements. And this, again, is in the event that you are interested in approving this proposed development. Number one, the approval applies only to the plan presented at the May 25th, 2021 Oldham County Planning Commission public hearing. Number two, there should be no subdivision of any lot into greater number of lots without review by the Oldham County Planning Commission. Number three, the preliminary plan must comply with all established federal, state, and county ordinances and requirements at the time of approval, and no record plat shall be approved until all standards are satisfied. Okay, so those are three typical ones. Number four is there are four specific improvements to modernize Rose Island Road that must be made in accordance with the traffic impact study. A, on the west side of Rose Island Road, add a 3-foot shoulder for 150 feet on Rose Island Road in both directions at the new entrance and at Harmony Village Road that will taper into the existing pavement. I've added
four trees within Rose Island Road right of way as designated by the Kentucky Transportation Panel for clear zoning improvement. E, widen existing Harmony Village Road from Rose Island Road to the proposed subdivision entrance and taper to the existing Harmony Village Road pavement. Number five, the proposed development must comply with the Oldham County Fire Hydrant ordinance. Number six, the landscape buffer plan must be submitted and approved prior to the issuance of any building permits. Seven, the cumulative phasing plan shall limit the number of building permits issued to 35 per year, beginning with the record plan. Number eight, no lot shall have driveway access to Rose Island Road or Harmony Village Road. Number nine, all comments by reviewing agencies must be met. Number 10, street lighting to be LGD dark sky fixtures. Number 11, the developer shall be restricted to the following site access timing. A, initial site development for grading and road, etc., shall occur only between the hours of 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, and 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Saturday, closed on Sunday. B, during home construction, builders' construction activity shall be limited to 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday, and closed on Sunday. And item number 11 was submitted by the developer. They had it as part of their slides, but we didn't really. Number 12, all construction traffic shall access the site via Kentucky Highway 1793 and shall utilize a designated construction entrance to the Street E access point off Rose Island Road, and this is for phase one. Another part of that is phase two construction entrance shall be Street B access point on the Harmony Village Road. Again, we heard that during the testimony. Item number 13, construction plans shall not be approved until all required permits from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Kentucky Division of Water, and other Oldham County agencies have been received by the Oldham County Engineering Department. Number 14, all detention basins shall be regularly maintained and kept free of sediment and debris, especially after storm or flooding events. Number 15, for construction plan approval, the applicant shall provide evidence that the performance of the basins for the required return events are not adversely affected by the water surface elevation, the rising fall, the adjoining floodway, and floodplain. Number 16, an as-built survey of the detention basins will be prepared to assure they are built correctly. Number 17, post-development flow shall not exceed pre-development flow leaving the site and currently proposed outfalls. As an example, proposed basins 1 and 2, and the outfalls between lots 18 and 40. Temporary sediment basin shall be used to control stormwater and sediment runoff to adjoining properties. And then there's the consideration of archaeological investigation and environmental, and I have written and proposed planning elements that I think we should discuss that.
Okay. Mr. Brady, I'll ask you, are you okay with what's been proposed at this point?
We are.
Let me get you on the record here. All right, commissioners, at this point, we are down to on docket PC 21010, which is an application for Canfield Realty and Development for approval of a preliminary subdivision plan of 94 lots, approximately 217.7 acres, known as Rose Island Lane. So at this point, I think I will open up for motions on the docket here for the preliminary subdivision plan. And once we get a motion and a second, then we'll open it up for discussion.
you, Mr. Chairman. Based on testimony and evidence and rebutted evidence presented, I find the application is consistent with subdivision regulations and the Oldham County Planning and Zoning Ordinance. Therefore, I move for approval. I find that it is in compliance with the comprehensive plan and would attach the binding elements as articulated by Mr. Urban in his motion, pending additional discussion about potential other items.
Okay. Do we have a second? All right, let me ask Mr. Clark. Is that an adequate motion, sir?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Do we have a second? The same seconds. All right, now we'll open it up for discussion. Discussion to discuss, you know, the proposed binding elements, any conditions that we want to make and consider, and then, you know, then we'll proceed with the further discussion. Mr. King.
Yes, I have a question on the binding element 14. Is there, how will this be enforced?
Well, when the a subdivision goes to record, one of the requirements that we have is a maintenance agreement for all stormwater structures, and it is prepared by the applicant and is signed by Judge Vogel, and it is reviewed by the county engineer's office, and then when we record the plat, we record it's a stormwater agreement, but still getting the maintenance. So that sets in motion who's supposed to do it. So initially it's the developer, and eventually it's the homeowner association.
So good. I mean, in this situation where this would be a fairly large stormwater basin, because it's saying, given the flooding potential that it will have during the river time, they could catch some very large stuff. They would be required to rent or own equipment capable of removing that interior.
That's correct.
Including silt, federal, tree trunk.
Anything and everything that's required to maintain that in its original capacity.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
For design capacity. All right. Any further discussion? Motion for this one.
Binding element 13. Construction plans shall not be approved until water park permits from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Kentucky Division of Water, and other Oldham County agencies have been received by the Oldham County Engineering Department. Does that cover the ordinance that was mentioned in regard to the septic and the floodplain? Would that be their permitting to review that and accept those septic systems in the floodplain? I feel like we are talking about ordinances that the agencies are required to make the decisions on.
Well, first of all, the health department is the one who regulates septic systems, regardless of where they are.
proposal is that no homes would be constructed in the Oldham. If they, by some chance, are, they would have to elevate the structures above 2 feet above the base level. So we regulate that in the modular. I would be remiss in issuing a building permit if I didn't have to require them to do an elevation certificate on the ones that appear to be close to the floodplain. Because again, on a map, it may not look like it's in the floodplain, but the best way to determine whether it is or isn't is the elevation certificate. That also protects the individual homeowner because now they know whether they're in that floodplain, they know whether they'll be suspect of a subject to flood insurance, which is going to be very, very high on the policy. So in terms of the individual construction of homes, we watch over that all the time. In terms of stormwater and retention basins in the floodplain, I really have to defer to the engineers. Mostly because I don't understand the calculations. I mean, I think I do because I've been doing this a long time, but I don't do math. And during the construction plan phase of this development that were to be approved, all of that would be reviewed. On a preliminary plan level, we require Oldham County a lot more than most jurisdictions do to make sure that we are presenting as much information as possible for the commissioners to make a decision. So, are there very specific calculations that have already been done on this? No, because again, that's done during the construction plan. We work very closely with the county office, of course, the Corps of Engineers, Division of Water. In terms of comments regarding stormwater management within the floodplain itself, I'm going to limit my comments to this. I mean, as stated, every drop of rain makes a difference to the people that are already there in this flood area. You know, as a floodplain coordinator, every time it rains in the season or the nightly flooding, I get concerned because a lot of things happen. You have to shut off power, you have to work on evacuating people. After the flood, we have to get power restored in the properties. So, if every drop of rain in the flood plain matters, regardless of whether it's during the flood event, I mean during a rain event or during the flooding that occurs afterwards. And so, again, always cautious about not crossing the line. But I again, work with Jim Sullivan, our county engineer. Many discussions about pension-based security, about stormwater management, and security, and especially in the
flood.
Senator,
do you have that?
We kind of already heard this testimony.
Correct.
You know, we, and I said kind of, we did. We talked about it, and we presented a staff.
All right, any further discussion? Any mistakes?
Speaking of the septic system, we spoke about yesterday, although you said it was a cost to run the sewer. Is it true that if you ran the sewers there,
you can discuss amongst us or all staff, but not there.
If we made them put the sewers there, then they would go back and reduce the lot size so we could put them there, and then we put more traffic on the road.
That's correct. When we have reviewed other proposals on this property that were on sewers, because of the cost of the running the line, the pump station, and the electric involved in phase three electric to run that pump station, it then kind of pushes this thing into a level of economic necessity, if you will, to reduce the lot size. Our regulation also says, if in R2 is an example, if you have sewers, you can do 12,000 square foot instead of minimum 1 acre. So I don't know the economics of this proposal on sewers, but I know that the previous ones have probably been the only way to run sewers is to make it in the place.
Any further discussion? This motion, proposed motion to approve. Any further discussion? So at this point, I think we'll move into voice vote. This is you, and this will be on docket BC 21010, application from Canfield Real
Bobby?
No.
Is there Finney?
I'm really, really torn on this because I believe this is a good development. I have been on Rose Island Road, and I've been on 1793 with an 18-wheel.
Yeah, no testimonies.
I'm trying to testify this fact. I'm going to vote no.
Mr. Heflin?
Yes.
Ms. Hagan?
Yes.
Mr. Hampton?
No.
Mr. King?
Yes.
Mr. Klingenfuss?
Yes.